Okay, well, welcome. Today's webinar, the title you can see there is Do You Want Dividend Income from Your Portfolio? So this webinar is aimed at those of you that are considering building a share portfolio for dividend income. If you have a quality dividend portfolio and enough time, you can build a diversified share portfolio that will provide enough income to support you or support your lifestyle long after you've stopped working. So that is the main theme today, is obviously talking about a share portfolio of dividend income. But you can also see there by the subtitle, that's a subtitle from James MacArthur, and the actual quote is, "And I had an old-fashioned idea that dividends were, excuse me, a good thing." So what I mean by that is dividend investing is a robust or healthy investment style. We're talking about different style, be it value investing or growth investing. In the past webinars, we've discussed also investing for income. So dividend investing is a robust investment style. That number one. And number two, dividend shares have outperformed non-dividend paying companies over the last, oh, quite a few many, over a long period of time. So we'll talk about it in more detail just now. But many of you have heard of a guy called John D. Rockefeller, one of the richest men that's ever lived. Do you know the only thing that gives me pleasure is to see my dividends coming in? Okay, so we're talking about dividend income today. And he has a quote from someone also that I admire a lot, a guy called Robert Kiyosaki. He's the author of many books. Some of you might have known of him from the book Rich Dad, Poor Dad. But his quote was, "The key to financial freedom and great wealth is a person's ability or skill to convert earned income or active income into passive income or passive and or portfolio income." There's another author that I follow, one of my mentors is a guy called T.R.F. Ecker. A quote from him, he says, "You become financially free when your passive income exceeds your expenses." So that is the framework or the context that I want to talk about. So, there's only two ways to make money, and I've said this in the past. You can work, or when I say there's two ways to make money, I mean about that legally, you either work for your money or your money works for you. So what is the current situation for a lot of people? There's another quote I came across from a lady called Anita Roddick. Says there's only two ways to make money, the hard way and a very hard way. So you saw now what I said, now there's only two ways to make money. You can work for it or your money can work for you. I don't believe Anita's quote is true, although some of you might believe that. But what if I can show you that is alternative way to call it making a passive income. We'll talk about a more passive income just now. But the idea that building wealth through passive income obviously has appeal for a lot of people. But saying that, a lot of people also worried, have they got enough saved up for retirement? So we'll talk about the rule of 4% just now, the 4% withdrawal rule just now. But if you want to generate, and I'm simplifying it here, if you want to generate 1,000 rand a month in retirement income from a portfolio, you need to have at least 250,000 rand saved up. Okay, so that's just simplified it as such. That's assuming a 5% withdrawal rate. In other words, 250,000 times your 5% will equal to 12,500 rand per month. So obviously divided by 12 months, it comes to just over 1,041 rand per month. Okay, so the idea is to create different income streams, be it from rental income, from, and today we're talking about shares and obviously dividend income. But Investopedia, if you go to the website, Investopedia defines passive income as earnings an individual derives from rental property or a limited partnership or other enterprise or other business in which he or she is not actively involved. So that's Investopedia's definition. Pop culture or popular culture would define passive income as any money you earn while sitting on the beach sipping a mojito. Okay, I call that beach money. And I think a lot of us like to be in that situation where we don't have to worry about it. But basically, what we're talking about today falls between the two. We talk about defining passive income as the money you earn from investment after you made the initial contribution of time or money. Okay, so Very important to understand that it's time and money. Many people think that passive income is about getting something for nothing. In other words, that get rich quick scenario. But in the end, it all involves work, cash, or as I said, just now, time. And we'll talk about it in more detail just now. So the current situation for a lot of people, and I might stand on some toes here, but some of you that have maybe have seen this already. This is from Robert Kiyosaki, and specifically his book called Cashflow Quadrant. Going back to what I said just now, you can either work for your money or your money can work for you. So on this side of the coin, let me just keep my spotlight here. We got 95% of the population on this side of the quadrant. Okay, 95% of the population working for changing their time for money. Okay, you can be an employee having a job, or you can be self-employed, be it a doctor, lawyer, you can go to so far as a brain surgeon, even as a ditch digger, you're changing time for money. So 95% of the population earns 5% of the wealth. On this side of the quadrant, we have the business owner and the investor. This is where 95% of the wealth comes from, and it's only 5% of the population. So obviously, a lot of people want to get to the side of the coin. So we're talking about moving in today's presentation, moving to the scenario here where you're earning money off your investments. So as I going back to what I said just now, as an employee or self-employed, you're changing your time for money. As a business owner, you're leveraging off what I call other people's time. Yes, your staff. So it's leveraging off your staff and other people's ideas. Okay, that's what we talk about as a business owner. When I say business owner, we're talking about a company that has more than 500 employees. Okay, when we talk about investors, this we leverage what I call over leveraging off other people's money. Okay, so just taking a you know call it leveraging with CFDs, whatever the case might be, just leveraging it up and money making money. So we're talking about active income and passive income. So active income, as I said just now, is working for your money. Means doing something, for example, some kind of work in order to receive money. This will include obviously salaries and wages and salaries and tips and commissions, if I had to put it all together. But it's you're involved in making that money. As I said, you're changing time for money. Other side of the coin, as I say, passive income. Remember, it's all leading up to what I want to talk about just now about dividends. Passive income is earnings you as an individual derive, for example, from a rental property, but you're earning a regular income with little or no effort required from you. So in other words, it's mostly hands off. So that is the framework I want to talk about today, and that's leading up to let me just get rid of my cursor here. The ideal situation. The ideal situation, you want to be in a situation where the power of passive income can change your life. What I mean by that is where you can allow you to live the life that you want to live without having to worry about the finances. And I know a lot of you guys on this webinar today would like to be in that situation. If you want to know the quickest way to financial freedom, it's passive income. And you can go Google that and you'll find that a lot of people will talk about that. I saw something the other day, millionaires have at least seven different income streams. So that's also a clue there. So with passive income, you're truly free. And that goes back to what I said just now about beach money. You can do as you please. You don't have to worry about working. You're making your money while you sleep. And that goes into my next slide here. If you look at my little cursor here, passive income is making money while you're sleeping. One way of looking at it also, I heard this the other day, it's the difference between rolling out of bed in the morning or rolling over in bed in the morning. That's what passive income allows you to do. And the bottom one here, it always reminds me of that Nedbank advert where they talk about money babies. This is your money making money. In other words, earning interest on interest. So that's why we talk about passive income. But ultimately, this is going back to my beach money scenario, passive income is financial freedom. To me, financial freedom leads to time freedom. You know, if and combine the two together, financial freedom and time freedom gives me what I call freedom of choice. And I think most of you on this webinar would like to be in a situation where you have what I call freedom of choice, having the money and the time to do what you want to, when you want to, with who you want to. In my situation, you can see by the slide there, is my family is my why. That's why I do the things. Okay. So this is all, as I say, quick introduction. What's important is going back to what I said just now. How much capital capital do you need to be comfortable? Like, is that just to meet expenses, or do you want to maintain your lifestyle? And that's where we talk about this 4% drawdown rule. Now, I've mentioned this in previous webinars. For every 4,000 rand a month that you need in income, you need at least 1 million rand in capital. So you can see that just a rough ballpark figures. It just tells you how much money income you generate from your nest egg, your retirement fund, without having to worry about outliving your money. So, it's something we talk about the 4%. Some people say it might be misleading. You might need 4.5%, obviously to adjust for inflation thereafter, things like that. But you go through all the stuff you find on the internet, they find that 4% is a good ballpark or rule of thumb to work on. So 4% income a month, you need at least 1 million rand in capital. Okay, so important to look at it in that scenario. But obviously things can change. We're going to have runaway inflation. We can have a global recession. We can have banking crisis, and obviously your retirement funds can be drained away very quickly. So like we've spoken about previous webinars, you need to diversify your assets, different asset classes, be it physical property, whatever the case might be. But today's webinar, we're focusing on shares, and we're focusing on dividend income. Some financial advisors say that you need to be able to replace 70% of your pre-retirement income after you stop working. So let's assume you and your spouse are earning 500,000 rand a year, or roughly say combined income of say about 42,000 a month. To generate 70% of your current income after you retire, you need to come up with about 29,000 rand per month. Okay, how do I calculate that? You can also do the other way around. This is how to do the math. Multiply your monthly income you need from your savings by 12, and then divide that product by 0.045 if you're working on that 4.5%. So in other words, 20,000 rand per month times 12 equal to 240,000, divided by the 0.045, it comes up to 533,000 if you want to have that kind of income. Okay, so that's your nest egg you need to have, and that's why I've got this little nest egg at the bottom. So that gives you just a background. So how do we get there? What are we proposing today? So for most investors, a safe and sound retirement is priority number one. But obviously, most of the investors also have all the investment accounts, be it unit trusts or share portfolios or rental properties, for example, that don't meet that criteria. So we're worried about having a comfortable retirement, but also we're worried about being in a situation where we're living off our investments enough, to last us a long enough time. So what are we proposing today? And that's that combination of that 4.5% is instead of just living off the interest income from bonds or savings accounts and selling units or selling shares, you're going to be in a situation where you want to prevent reducing your capital. So one way to do that is to enhance your retirement income and invest in dividend-paying shares or exchange-traded products. We've spoken about that before, or unit trust, or combination of all of them. So over time, over a period of time, the cash flow generated by these dividend payments can supplement your pension income, okay, your retirement income. And some of you might also have living annuities and things like that. So these are all different vehicles for you to have that income in retirement. So here's an example. This is from our website, Species Wealth website. One of the strategies that I mentioned just now is investing for dividends. This is our top 10. I think it was about 2 or 3 days ago, so these numbers are slightly old. But you can see most of them here. You've got MMI, you've got Barclays, you've got Liberty, Clientele. Most of the high dividend yielding companies are banks and insurance companies. So in this scenario, let's say for example that this is one strategy for choosing shares. Remember I said you can also use value investing and growth investing. And I've used this in the past where I say I created a call it a fruit salad investment approach, where I have some value stocks, some growth stocks. But my big thing is also I want high dividend yielding or high dividend paying companies in my portfolio. So imagine a scenario where you had bought 10,000 rands worth of MMI, which is the old Metropolitan Momentum merger a few years ago. So, if you go on, before years ago, you decided to buy about 10,000 rands worth of shares. You would have bought roughly about 21 rand 20, and it would have given you roughly about 460 shares. Also, obviously, allowing for brokerage costs and things like that. So you can see how the share's gone. Yeah, we have a nice little run up until middle of 2015, and since then the share price has come down. We're focusing on the dividends. I just want to highlight something for you guys. You would have received eight dividend payments over the time period, and I just paid dividends last week. You received, when I say eight dividend payments, remember twice a year, interims and finals. You've got about 4.93 cents, or 4.93 in dividends. Multiplied by your 460 shares over the time period, we received 2,270 rand and 61 cents. Now, just understand, obviously, this is net of dividend withholding tax. That's first of all. Okay, number one. Number two, that over that period, that 2,220, 2,270 rand as a percentage of my initial investment will give me 23%. So over 4 years, I'm getting about 5.82% just from the dividend income from Momentum. Okay, so the point I'm trying to make here is, and by the way, you've still got your 460 shares in MMI. Okay, so imagine that's one share in a portfolio of between 8 and 12 different shares. Okay, so this is how you create a dividend income. So if you choose a very stable company that pays out a very steady dividend, this type of approach will earn a very reliable income for you. On the other hand, if you only invested in one company, like for example, MMI, you would probably obviously need to invest in more stocks. So obviously, it'd be limited. So you need to also, you might also want to invest into ETFs or unit trusts or to spread your risk. Remember, rule number one, avoid capital losses. Rule number two, never forget rule number one. But obviously, by adding more shares onto your portfolio, it might give you a bit of a lesser return. So, what are the benefits? So, there are three main benefits of going for what I call dividend-paying shares. It helps you look, you be in the better quality stocks you're looking at, so the company health, you'll have a lower risk, and thirdly, obviously, the investment returns. So, when we talk about company health, nobody wants to invest in a share only to discover that the company is in financial trouble. Choosing a dividend-paying share improves your odds of picking a winner because companies that pay dividends on a regular basis are consistently making a profit. Okay, so we talk about mature companies paying a profit. They've been around for a long time. So we talk about quality companies that are sustainable and that kind of stuff. That's why it's especially true a company that has a long history of increasing its dividends over a period of time. Now, growing dividend payouts also tell you that the company's management are confident or is confident, and that the company's good performance will continue. Management have incentive, obviously incentive to exercise that fiscal discipline and the prudent management. And obviously, investors are attracted to companies like that. So that's what I mean by company health. Number two, the lower risk. Share prices of companies with long track records of dividend payments tend to be less volatile. Okay, less volatile than average. Dividend-paying companies provide stability and obviously a steady income stream. That's also very important. And you'll find, especially right now, and I've been talking about this for months now, the uncertainty on the markets and the volatility, especially in times where we have a scenario where markets are unstable or experiencing a downturn. You want to be in a situation where you want price stability. So dividend-paying companies, those are the kind of shares you want in your portfolio. And obviously, you can also reduce your original investment risk with each dividend payout you get. In other words, you buy a share for 50 rand, that pays that two rand dividend yield. Every 2 rand gets paid to you is being returned to you on a yearly basis. That's why another way of looking at it. So investment returns, what I mean by that, is that dividend-paying shares tend to provide above-average returns. Mentioned just now, compared over the long term to non-paying dividend-paying shares, much better returns you're getting there. So it's a combination of capital growth and dividend income. That's what you're looking for. And that's why I'm saying that whole fruit salad approach, value plus growth plus dividends, that's the combination you want. Okay, so I hope those are the three main benefits you'll get from high dividend-paying companies. So go one step further, and I know some of you on this webinar today, you'll say, "Yeah, it's a great idea, but gee, I'm already retired. What must I do then?" So yes, we're talking about compounding dividend income is advantageous if you have a long time horizon. But what happens if you're in retirement already? For those investors, those of us that are looking at that very soon, dividend growth plus a higher yield would do the trick. So in other words, this is what you're looking at for high yielding shares, like the listed property companies, as well as preference shares. And one of the examples there, and we'll get back to just now, is the Grindrod ETFs. But how do you pick a good dividend paying company? So there's various criteria we can look at. First of all, you want to check the current, and that's what we did just now. You want to check the current dividend yield percentage. Many dividend bank there are many companies paying out high dividends, but remember what's important is sustainability. Now you should factor that paying at least 3% is what the market's paying. I like to look at companies with 5% plus, and obviously you dig a bit deeper. So you also need to look at a long dividend history. Look for a company with a long dividend history. Many companies pride themselves on continuously paying out those dividends for many, many years. So those are the companies you're looking for. You're also looking for companies that are increasing their dividends every year. That's the ideal situation you're looking for. You're looking for companies that come back to what I said just now with the not too high. You want to be in a situation where the dividend payout ratio, you'll see the next two slides where I reference that, is less than 80% of the earnings. Now, if I get worried where the company's paying out 75, where the company's earning 50 cents, but it's paying out a dividend of 75 cents, that tells me, whoa, this company is either borrowing money and paying out that more than it's getting from its earnings. Little red flag should be waving there for me. Whoops, sorry, we go back. Sorry, wrong button. You also want to be choosing a company that, and this is what comes back to the big blue chip shares, they have a worldwide market presence. The main idea there is you want to hedge against inflation. So if you're growing your dividends by 2%, inflation is much higher than it, you're going nowhere. So it's important to have a diverse. Again, come back to the portfolio, diverse portfolio. You want to go for big companies with a stable product line, whether it's beer, we just saw breweries going off the market now, food, oil, you name it. You want to invest in a company that its core business is a need for it. There's a need for its products and there's growth potential. You want to go into a company that has lots of cash. Cash, they always say cash is king. Cash is the lifeblood of your company. So a dividend paying company should have lots of cash. You can look at the current ratio, which measures the ability to meet its short-term obligations. The current ratio is the ratio between current assets to current liabilities. If the company's current ratio is greater than one, it's in a good shape. There are a lot of financial ratios you can use, but on our website, we use the EPS. Sorry, cash flow per share as a percentage of EPS, and there we want to see a steady increase more than 0.75. You want to see a company sticking to its knitting, sticking to its core business. You want to see a company that's got price stability. We've spoken about it already. Share buybacks, I find that also quite interesting, especially where you find that some of the sectors, some of the better yields are in sectors that are experiencing more volatility. So a prudent investor, a careful investor will diversify his portfolio amongst different stocks. We've spoken about it before, 8 to 12 different stocks across 3 to 5 different sectors. And obviously, the whole idea there is to reduce the market swings. When I talk about the share buybacks, if you want to be in a situation where a company has enough earnings to pay good dividends and buy back some of its shares at a time. And obviously, if I buy back some of my shares, my earnings increases and things like that. So these are just some of the criteria you might want to look at to help you choose those high dividend paying shares. But to simplify for you, on our website, if you log in with your username and password, this is going back to the old PSG website, the online website, click on research and click on the search button. These are the three different investment styles I mentioned just now. Investing for value, investing for growth, but this is the criteria we're talking about here, investing for dividends. So you click on that criteria to search our database. In this scenario, on the value tab here, I'm looking at high dividend yields, and then you can see the criteria there, okay? More than 3%. If I click on the second tab, which is that quality view, I'm looking at dividends as a percentage of my earnings. Remember, you don't want to be in a situation where paying out more than 80%. So those are two ways of filtering out the stocks for yourself. And I suggest you don't just go blindly on these now, go dig a bit deeper. Look at the historical history. If you click on each individual share, it'll take you to the share info page, and from there, dig a bit deeper. This is one way to scan through those shares. Just looking at the time here quickly. So I mentioned just now about the ETFs, and the last two webinars we have spoken about the core and satellite strategy. You might have 50% of your shares in ETFs and 50% of your shares in high dividend yielding stocks. So in this scenario, as a hypothetical example, 17% you might want to put into PropTrax, which is the top 10 property shares, 17% into PrefTrax, which is preference shares, and DivTrax. And then, as I say, high dividend yielding stocks, but you're diversifying. I don't want to go into too much detail here, but obviously I'm using example. So this is from Core Shares, the PropTrax 10. What does it follow? It follows, as I say, the top 10 property shares. You can see the historical dividend there. So that's just a way of just getting higher yield. So 4.99% through one share, I have access to a basket of 10 listed property companies. PrefTrax, through one share, I have access to a range of different preference shares that pay out high preference shares. Okay. And if you div tracks, I'm looking for companies with stable dividends, and I'm looking for a long history. And you can see the average historical dividend yield there. So this is just an example, what I was mentioning just now, how to add on to create a high yield portfolio. So let me see what kind of questions you guys have got today. Questions. Oh, a lot of good questions coming through here. Cool. Okay, well, Jan, long, big question, yeah. Jan, I have to break your question down. You got to, in the cases of CFR, which is Richemont, the foreign tax rate on dividend income is around 26%, which is higher than RSA-based shares, and there is a long waiting period for the rebate. Also, forfeited income in returns and interest loss, etc. Is there anything that can be done about this as more and more companies are likely to follow the strategy? Jan, you need to. I'm not a tax consultant. I don't know what the strategy would be going forward on that. But I would suggest it's create a diversified portfolio. So, Jan, I'll have to do an investigation on that. Are pref tracks not being phased out? This is a question from Hendrik Vogel. Not to my knowledge. Remember, there's three different asset classes or three different kinds of shares. Most of the shares listed on the JSE are ordinary shares. Preference shares, the difference between a preference share and ordinary shares when it comes to dividends, they have preferential treatment. Just another source of capital for the companies to raise capital. I'm not 100% sure of them being phased out. I haven't heard about that one, Hendrik. Question here from David again, David Yanks. Would a selection of good high-yielding listed property shares give a safe high yield? That's as I suggested with the PropTrax. That's through one share, you have exposure to I'm using PropTrax, which is the top 10. I hope that answers your question. Here's a question from Eleanor. In the current market, would you invest in a share where the dividend is less than the bank interest rate? In that scenario, it could be that the share price is high and obviously the yield is low. You find when the prices come down, the yield goes up. Again, Eleanor, the best thing to do to protect yourself there is to, again, it depends on your strategy. Are you looking at value or are you looking at growth or is your focus more on the income? Build a diversified portfolio is the way I'd look at it. The bank interest rates are around about 3 or 4% anyway. So yeah, I want to go for companies giving you 1%. Obviously, it's a company that might be reinvesting all the money back into the business, especially a new company. They go for future growth or invest all the money back into the business. Might be a growth company then. Guys, thanks for the questions. A lot of questions coming through here. The formula for DY is current price divided by dividends. Whoa, sorry, things are jumping around here. But this dividends term is over a period of what time? That's usually analyzed. That's a year. Yeah, David, going back to your question, yeah, yield on property tax is only 5%. You can buy Fairvest by itself and you get a 10% yield. Yeah, you can do that too. I'm going to say through one share, you have a basket of shares. So, yeah, but I'm also highlighting the property shares in general. Okay. There we go. Eleanor, you're getting 7% in the bank. Well done. Awesome. Dividend yield could give a false impression of a high yield when the share price drops. Yes, I agree with that, Jan. Yeah. So very important to us, as I say, you need to dig a bit deeper. Okay. Good questions, guys. Sorry, I'm just going down my list here. That gets all the questions. Cool. Yes, awesome. Okay. Guys, so that looks like all the questions. Let me just wrap this up quickly. Let's get out the way here. In conclusion, what I want you to remember from this presentation today, going back to what I said right in the beginning, our main question. Remember we said, do you want your dividend income in your portfolio? My answer would be yes. So what are the most choice, picking shares on dividend incomes, one of the most straightforward stock picking strategies. As I say, it gives you the health. So obviously be focusing more on the mature, more established companies. There's an old saying in the market, elephants don't gallop. So you'll get your companies giving you 20% growth per annum and your 3% dividend yield that'll give you year in, year out. But your focus should be on finding good companies with sustainable high dividend yields. Obviously, to receive a steady and predictable income stream. That is your main objective. But don't just go based on dividends alone. Okay, that's one of my little caveat there. Dividends do not equal lower risk. So that's what I want you to gain from this presentation today. So in conclusion, or your next steps, those of you that haven't got an account with us yet, come register for an equity trading account on our website. You'll have access to our research tools and things like that. You can play around with our trading simulator, create what if scenarios. As you mentioned right in the beginning, PDF and the recording will send out to you either tomorrow or by Friday the latest. Next week we're talking about old school and new school investments. That should be quite also interesting. Week after that, we talk about how secure is your financial future. And then asset allocation will be the last one for October. I should hopefully have up in the next week or so the agenda for November before I run off to Vegas again. Okay. Cool. Guys, thanks from my side. There's my contact details, my email address. But you also can get all of our sales guys on the wealth desk. There's the email address, wealth@phg.co.za. But from my side, thank you very much for being on this webinar. Until next week, all the best and bye for now.